Thank you. Welcome to University United Methodist Church. We are so excited to be here together this morning for worship. My name is Toby Nguyen. I'm the pastor of Discipleship and Nurture. As the service begins, you can register your attendance, submit a prayer request, or access the bulletin by following the link in this post. We're so excited today that we begin our virtual missions project with the Methodist Church in Argentina. You can find out more about that on our website. Let us now center our hearts and minds for worship. Let us join together in the opening prayer. Lord Jesus, you taught your disciples to cast a wide net. Not for fish, but for people. Teach us the fishing craft. Make our fingers nimble so we may handle hearts and hands gently. Make our minds quiet and patient while we serve those who are not yet ready to receive you. And make our hearts hungry for your word, for the sake of the one who has captured our hearts already, Jesus Christ. Amen.
I'm Rebecca. I'm a children's minister in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. We are 2 weeks into this University's Got Talent, and I've been super busy. It's so exciting to be a contestant on this show.
And I'm Charlie, a youth pastor in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. And I have to say, I'm not nearly as excited as I once was.
How is that possible? I mean, this game show is fascinating.
Fascinating. It's also nerve-wracking. 3 weeks ago, the judges gave us an insane amount of prize money, and then they just went away with no instructions other than they could come back at any time.
Yes, that is what is so exciting. I mean, we get to figure out what to do with all of this prize money. I've got a plan, and I've been really busy putting it into action.
Really? You have a plan? You've been busy? How did you figure out what to do?
Well, I mean, here's what I know about the judges. They were incredibly generous to give away so much prize money. I think that means they believe in the power of the gift to accomplish some real good in the world. I think it also means that they really believe in you and me. If they're going to trust us with all this cash, I mean, so I've been trusting my gut and putting the prize money back into the community. You know, I'm paying it forward.
I don't know. That just doesn't seem to me like what judges would want. It seems too risky. I've watched a lot of reality game shows in my day, and the judges are always harsh and critical. One mistake and it's curtains. I don't think they want us to use the prize money at all. So, well, I've hidden it under my bed.
Don't you think that's a risk too? These judges don't seem like other judges to me. I think you could try on a little courage and really put that prize money to use. There's so much good we can do.
No, thanks. I've made up my mind. I'm just going to sit on it and see what happens when the judges come back.
Well, good luck. I'm off to see if I can help some more people. So I'll see you soon, Charlie.
Okay, see you soon, Rebecca. Whoa, I'll be right here.
Then he who had received the one talent came and said, "Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown, and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid, and went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours." The third servant had something that the other two servants didn't have that was a key to holding him back: fear. One of the main indicators that someone is operating out of fear is when they make excuses versus taking action. The first two servants got right to work and took action. However, the third servant started making excuses when it was time for him to account for what he had or had not done. There is nothing that will rob us of opportunity and stand in the way of us being courageously generous, more than being afraid. We are invited to enter in to courage.
God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
I'm excited to have David Olilla with me for week number three of our generosity campaign. David?
Well, Justin, it's great to be back. And first of all, I want to thank Jennifer Woods for filling in for me last week for the live stream at both the 9 and the 11 o'clock service. We are entering in, as our generosity campaign goes. We started with enter in to your opportunity. We had a lovely passage from 2 Corinthians that reminded us all that God loves a cheerful giver. We then moved into enter in now with the parable of the talents. And it demonstrated to us that investing in the kingdom of God is a now thing that you need to act accordingly. So this week, we're going to hear from Pastor Creighton, and we're going to look closer at the third servant. What did he do? He put the talent in the ground. Why did he do that? And if you listen to the parable, it was because of fear. It was because of fear that he was thinking he would lose it. And so what's the opposite of fear? Courage. You have to have the courage to start to give. You have to have courage to expand your giving. And so this week, we are entering into courage. And so hopefully the mailings have reached you, and this is the enter in. And what I really want you to do, not that Pastor Justin doesn't have some nice words in the first page, but this is where I really think a pie graph tells it all. What we do at UUMC, as demonstrated by send, reach, and teach. And there's text for those of you that want to go in more detail. But this is how the generosity from our church has, again, helped us locally, helped us in the region, and helped us internationally. And so, Justin, I look forward to the words from Pastor Creighton, and I, again, am thankful to be the generosity chair for our church. Thank you.
Well, thank you, David. And I, too, look forward to Pastor Creighton's word. And I'm so thankful for this series and how it's helped us to enter in differently as we talk about generosity and think about the mission of our church. As we move into our time of offering, and you can text in your gift by texting University UMC to the number that's on the screen. If you're a member of another local church community, we encourage you to give locally as well. May we give with glad and generous hearts.
Sometimes I A reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. One day, Jesus was standing beside Lake Genesaret when the crowd pressed in around him to hear God's word. Jesus saw two boats sitting by the lake. The fishermen had gone ashore and were washing their nets. Jesus boarded one of the boats, the one that belonged to Simon, then asked him to row out a little distance from the shore. Jesus sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he finished speaking to the crowds, he said to Simon, "Row out farther into the deep water and drop your nets for a catch." Simon replied, "Master, we've worked hard all night and caught nothing, but because you say so, I'll drop the nets." So they dropped the nets, and their catch was so huge that their nets were splitting. They signaled for their partners in the other boat to come and help them. They filled both boats so full that they were about to sink. When Simon Peter saw the catch, he fell at Jesus' knees and said, "Leave me, Lord, for I am a sinner." Peter and those with him were overcome with amazement because of the number of fish they caught. James and John, Zebedee's sons, were Simon's partners, and they were amazed too. Jesus said to Simon, "Don't be afraid. From now on, you will be fishing for people." As soon as they brought the boats to the shore, they left everything and followed Jesus. The Gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, University United Methodist Church family. It's so good to be with you. Would you please join me in a word of prayer? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. We're here in week 3 of our sermon series entitled Enter In, which is based around the parable of the talents in Matthew 25. In this story, Jesus tells about a master who, before leaving on a long journey, entrusts 3 small fortunes to 3 servants based on their abilities. Matthew 25:15 says it this way: "To one he gave 5 talents, to another he gave 2, and to another he gave 1. He gave to each servant according to that servant's ability." It's this phrase, "according to the servant's ability," that I want to explore with you today in this encounter of Peter with Jesus in the Sea of Galilee in Luke 5. This text offers rich possibilities for reflecting on how God calls ordinary people to courageous discipleship, mission, and generosity. After all, there is nothing the slightest bit extraordinary about Simon Peter and his fishing partners. They are simple fishermen, and they are simply doing what they did every day. They're minding their own business, cleaning their nets after a long, particularly discouraging night of work, when Jesus comes along, enters into their utterly normal, mundane lives, and changes everything. Here's how Jesus did it. First, Jesus needed Simon and his boat. I remember a time on a Florida beach when the kids were all little, and as a matter of fact, I believe Cosmo was still having to wear a life vest, which he hated. I was on Cosmo duty in the waves when I noticed that the other two walked out of the water back up to the beach, what I thought to their mom. I kept swimming with Cosmo, and the next thing I noticed is that Cannon and Whippy come paddling up on a paddleboard, but we didn't bring one to the beach. I looked around to see if someone was missing it when I caught the eye of the 20-something in charge of the rentals, who just laughed and waved us on. Later, when we took the board back, he told me that they just walked up to him, smiled, and said, "We're going to use this, okay?" And to his surprise, he said, "Okay." Imagine Peter's surprise when Jesus sat down in his boat to teach the crowds that had gathered around him. He must have remembered Jesus from earlier when he healed his mother-in-law. Regardless, he might have been too tired to tell Jesus no or to realize what he was getting himself into. Simon had been fishing all night with no success, then working from the early morning hours cleaning his nets. Most likely he was exhausted and looking forward to going home and getting some sleep. So it must have seemed to be a bit of an imposition when Jesus got into his boat and asked him to put out a little way from the shore for official ministry business. Regardless, Simon did what Jesus asked him to do. Whether it was clear to him or not at that moment, Jesus needed Simon in his boat. One thing we learn really quickly about Jesus is that he begins to involve others in ministry almost immediately. In all four Gospels, Jesus begins his earthly ministry by recruiting others to join him, starting with Simon and his fishing buddies. Jesus needed Simon in his boat. Jesus needs you and me in our boats. God needs who we are and what we do and what we have to see God's kingdom come. Jesus wants to involve you, your boat, whether that's your education, your training, your possessions, your positions, your time, your gifts, your resources, your everything, because in Jesus' hands, the ordinary becomes extraordinary. Jesus needed Simon in his boat. Jesus needs yours and mine too. Second, Jesus wanted to take Simon out to deep water. Luke does not tell us what Jesus taught the crowds that morning. The focus of the story is on what happens afterwards. Jesus tells Simon to put out into the deep water and let down his nets for a catch. Simon obviously believes this to be a futile exercise. He is, after all, a professional fisherman. You can almost read between the lines, almost hear what Simon is thinking. The nerve of that guy. Doesn't he know what I do for a living? That preacher should just stick to his sermons. We can almost hear the exasperation in his voice when he responds, "Master, we have worked all night, but have caught nothing." But then he continues, "Yet, if you say so, I will let down the nets." He initially protests Jesus' instruction to go out to the deep waters and let down the nets because he is convinced that the fish aren't biting. They've worked all night and caught nothing. We can hardly blame him for his skepticism because we have the same thoughts ourselves. How often do we resist Jesus' claim on our lives because what he is calling us to do seems crazy or too impractical? How often do we avoid putting out into the deep waters of following and bearing witness to Jesus because we are convinced that we will not see any results? What might it mean for us to go deep sea fishing with Jesus, to trust and follow him outside of our comfort zones, to let go of our certainties, and to take him at his word? We know what happens next. The nets become so full of fish that they begin to break. Simon has to wave the other boat to come help, and when it gets out there, both boats begin to sink because there is a multitude of fish. The word Luke uses for the amount of fish or multitude is polis, the word used over a dozen times in the Acts of the Apostles, or AKA the sequel to Luke, for the multitude of people who believe the apostles' message about Jesus. Like Simon, Jesus wants us to take out to the deep water. Jesus wants to show us the place where faithfulness and fruitfulness meet if we dare listen and obey. And it's not only for Simon or for each of us individually, but those deep waters are a place where community is reimagined and relationships are rooted in the power and grace of our God. Think of what Simon would have missed out on if he had not gone back out in the deep water and had not thrown his nets back in. Think of what we will miss if we are content to play it safe near familiar shores, tired and tangled up in the empty nets of self-sufficiency. Jesus wants to take us out to the deep waters to show us what is possible by faith. Third, Jesus called Simon just as he was. One of my favorite fishing trips was when we went deep sea fishing with our troop back in Oklahoma. On the first day, our scoutmaster was trying to get everyone to take Dramamine so no one would get sick. And he made the mistake of asking Cosmo if he wanted to take it. Cosmo said no. The scoutmaster then spent the next hour trying to convince him to take it, saying that if he got sick, he was going to ruin the trip for everybody. Well, 2 hours into the trip, Cosmo was one of the last men standing. He's out there fishing and having a good old time, and everyone else is getting sick over the side of the boat, me included. And every time someone got sick, especially the scoutmaster, Scott Cosmo just smiled bigger and bigger. There's something about being on a boat out in deep waters that can humble you. Seeing the miraculous catch, Simon is humbled. He becomes overwhelmed with fear and wonder, sensing that he is in the presence of divine power. He responds by falling down at Jesus' knees and begging him, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." In the midst of an ordinary daily grind, and in fact, after a particularly lousy night of work, he's encountered by one who changes everything. Amazed by the power of God displayed in the abundant catch of fish, Simon is immediately aware of his sinfulness and unworthiness. He sees the overwhelming disparity between God's power manifest in Jesus and his own mortal, compromised life. Yet Jesus calls Simon and his partners just as they are. Simon is actually aware of his unworthiness. But Jesus is not put off by this in the slightest. Jesus does not ask Simon to get his act together, his resume prepared, and then come back for an interview. Rather, Jesus encounters him as he is, tells him not to be afraid, and calls him to a new mission of catching people. Throughout Scripture, we see that human sin, failure, and inadequacy are no obstacles to God's call. God calls imperfect people to do God's work, people who are aware of their unworthiness and are often doubting and resistant to God's call. Yet God doesn't wait for them to shape up. God calls them as they are and then works on shaping them into faithful servants. Jesus' mission does not wait until we think we're ready. Not for Simon and not for us. The need for the gospel in this broken world is far too urgent. We are called right now, even in spite of our frailties, failures, and doubts, even in the midst of our ordinary, busy, complicated lives. Jesus called Simon as he was. Jesus calls each of us as we are. Thanks be to God. And finally, Jesus redeemed Simon for God's rescue mission. In June of 2018, the world held its breath for 18 days as a group of elite cave divers risked everything to rescue 12 boys and their coach from an underwater cave in northern Thailand. These boys, who were all members of our soccer team, had gone into a long, winding underground cave with their coach to celebrate one of the boys' birthdays. But it was just before the beginning of the four-month monsoon season, and while they were in the cave, it started to downpour outside. Rain rushed into the cave, trapping them deep inside. As the days wore on, the Thai authorities brought in the Thai Navy SEALs, but discovered that they were not prepared or trained for this type of diving. This is where Rick Stanton, a hobbyist cave diver, and his buddies were brought in to help with the rescue. Listen to Rick explain why he was particularly qualified for this job, and I'm quoting now from an interview on NPR's Fresh Air. Rick says, "I wouldn't even describe myself as a diver. I'd say in US, you have the word spelunking, which is a person that explores a dry cave. I just say that I'm an underwater spelunker. So really, it's the caving skills that's forefront to us, not necessarily the diving. Our specialty, and that is what really came to the fore in Thailand, is not just going on a dive, but to carry your diving gear through a network of caves. So that's our specialty, which we have, this very strange hobby, which we've really pursued for 40 years, just for our own perverse enjoyment and pleasure. And what really brought home to me is how so suddenly it all became worthwhile. And then this obscure sideline hobby that no one could understand or vocalize all came good and was a huge benefit to those 13 young lives and done on a world stage. So I'm hugely proud of the event and the fact that my life almost, you could say, led to that point." When Simon saw the catch and who he was standing in the presence of, his priorities completely changed. In this one event, Simon was able to see how everything that had happened up to this point in his life had been preparing him for Jesus' invitation in Luke 5:10. In the most profound way, his life was redeemed by God's rescue mission when he was called to fish for people. He was redeemed to save others. Like Simon, we are all called by virtue of our baptism to participate in God's mission to the world in Jesus Christ. We are all called daily to reorient our priorities to align with God's priorities, to use the gifts God has given us in service to others, to share the good news of Christ in word and deed. God longs to redeem who we are, what we do, and what we have to rescue the lives of those around us. For most of us, this will not mean leaving our current professions behind, although we can't rule that out. It may mean allowing God to redeem our work for the sake of others. To be honest, I believe one of the greatest needs within the church is to recapture a deeper understanding of vocation and calling for all Christians. Your work matters. Your work matters to God, whatever you do. One helpful definition of vocation comes from Frederick Buechner, who defined vocation this way in his little book, Wishful Thinking. Vocation. It comes from the Latin vocare, to call. It means the work a person is called to do by God. There are all different kinds of voices calling you to all different kinds of work. And the problem is to find out which is the voice of God rather than that of society, say, or the superego or self-interest. By and large, a good rule for finding out is this: the kind of work God usually calls you to is the kind of work, A, that you need most to do, and B, the world most needs to have done. If you really get a kick out of your work, you've presumably met requirement A. But if your work is writing TV deodorant commercials, the chances are you've missed requirement B. On the other hand, if your work is being a doctor in a leper colony, you have probably met requirement B. But if most of the time you're bored and depressed by it, the chances are you have not only bypassed A, but probably aren't helping your patients much either. Here's where he wraps up. The place God calls you to is a place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meets. And this is a simple definition of vocation that I want you to remember. Hear this again. The place God calls you to is a place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meets. I'll close with one last thought from the interview with Rick Stanton, the cave diver who rescued the Thai boys and their coach. Rick said this: "And from that moment, when I came out of the cave, having found them, I completely changed. All my efforts were directed towards the rescue and saving of those boys." Whether Rick believes in God or not, he uttered one of the most clear articulations of vocation I've ever heard in my life. He became convinced that his years spent cave diving, his deep gladness, or as he said, his perverse enjoyment and pleasure, met the world's deep hunger in rescuing those boys. This story here in Luke ends in a similar way. Jesus expanded Simon and his buddies' vocational imagination by almost sinking their boats and calling them to fish for people. Some might say that Jesus interrupted their work and their livelihood, but I say that their calling became so clear that in verse 11, we read, "When they brought their boats back to shore, they left everything and followed him." My prayer today is that we would have the courage to enter into God's rescue mission by giving generously of who we are, what we do, and what we have to follow Jesus completely. And in so doing, I pray that you will find that place where your deep gladness and the world's deep hunger meet. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We've come to worship and we depart to serve. Remember that wherever you are, that's where the ministry of the church happens. And so as you go into this week, remember that we love you. We hope you have a great week, and may the peace of Christ be with you. Amen.
Jesus calls us, earth and tomb. smash that like button, subscribe, and turn on notifications.